I mean, if they have their fantasies, they do. I don't know. I don't know what they think of whatever, but I just walked to the ring and whatever was happening behind me, I'm not sure.
And you can't be held responsible for. So
No, we've
absolved Trish of all the blame. Welcome, welcome, welcome to After the Bell. I am still Corey Graves. We are barreling toward Backlash in San Juan, Puerto Rico. The draft is on the horizon, and as we do each and every week, we've got you covered here on ATB. Joining me, as he does each and every Monday, KP, Kevin Patrick. This is going to be a wild one. It's a Hall of Fame-worthy episode of After the Bell because we will be graced with the presence of none other than WWE Hall of Famer Trish Stratus. I cannot wait to chat with the self-proclaimed GOAT. She made a lot of headlines this past Monday. But Kevin, we were chatting before we hit the record button. You've got quite a day ahead of you, don't you?
I do. Listen, let's go back a few days, because we had fun with Raw. We go to the bar afterwards, and the great Michael Hayes, Freebird, is just on one, and I'm just getting rinsed. You were enjoying yourself listening to that. Hurricane Helms was there as well. We had fun after the show.
You're incriminating people, KP.
I know.
Incriminating people already.
I know.
You have to leave the names out for the sake of everybody's well-being.
I think it was all, hopefully, in the name of love, I hope. But it was fun. It was fun. We enjoyed a beer after the show. We went to bed. We came home, and I arrived home to a squirrel problem. Again, these damn squirrels, man. Whatever it is about them, they just won't seem to leave our house alone. So yeah, I'm pulling out the Liam Neeson in Taken here. I'm gonna turn into a bit of a badass and go after these squirrels this afternoon.
You're going after the squirrels?
Yeah.
Full How do you on go after, after a squirrel? Listen, KP, me myself, I'm a bit of a squirrel expert. If you scroll through my Instagram, there's actually a photo of me luring a squirrel who climbed up my leg in Boston, and we became fast friends. We shared peanuts. It was a very lovely experience. So I've got a soft spot in my heart. I wake up every morning and I enjoy my squirrels. There are squirrels in my backyard in the city that my dog plays with.
Okay.
Just show a little respect to the squirrel.
Show a little respect. These little critters are chewing on the wires, man. I'm traveling. There's going to be a fire in my house if I don't get rid of these squirrels.
Okay. When you say it like that, I don't want your house to burn down. I need you to be at 100% for the upcoming Raw, the upcoming draft. You mentioned Monday Night Raw. What a great time we had afterwards, because it was a great, it was a fun show. It was a nice, the energy from the crew, from everybody backstage after Monday Night Raw, it was a good one. It was, to me, a very nicely contained episode of Monday Night Raw. There was a lot that happened, but it felt like it was all wrapped up in a neat little bow, little package. It reminded me of sort of a singular issue of a comic book. Insert superhero here. You have the villains who have now united. You've got the Judgment Day and the Bloodline looking to take out X, Y, and Z. Kevin Owens, Sami Zayn, Riddle, Rey Mysterio. A lot happening. And in the end, you sort of got a little resolution and on to the next thing. It was a very easily digestible 3-hour show to me.
Yeah, and you say resolution, but it was anything but.
No, nothing ever gets resolved.
It totally backfired on the Judgment Day, on the Bloodline, on everybody. But what I loved was that opening scene, Gravy, because the Judgment Day appear, they interrupt the Bloodline. And in that moment, I, for one, you could tell I'm like, here we go. This is a territorial battle. The Judgment Day feel they run Raw. The Bloodline are kicking off the show. We're getting set for all-out war here between the two, but no. Paul Heyman up to his dirty little dealings. These nefarious negotiations that we saw, shaking the hand of Damian Priest. And what I loved about it was Jimmy and Jay blindsided. They had no idea, which in many ways hints that all may not be kosher and well within the Bloodline. Solo knew. Rhea didn't know. Finn didn't know, you know? So what are we to read into this? And then when it all played out, it was class. And then the stories within the show that were separate were wonderful. Bobby Lashley being derailed by Bronson Reed. I'm excited to see where that goes. And then the Hall of Famer that's on the show today, Trish Stratus, explaining her actions. She revealed that she was the one to take out Lita backstage, and then obviously her reasons for going after Becky.
Trish Stratus went scorched earth on Monday Night Raw, so I'm excited to get her thoughts in a little further depth. What stood out to me amongst all the madness in the 3 hours, Seth freaking Rollins versus The Miz. The internet, as of this morning, was still buzzing about The Miz's performance, as though they were surprised. And we told the story on commentary that Miz has felt disrespected. In the lead up to WrestleMania, to current day, Miz, for whatever reason, is Rodney Dangerfield. He can't get no respect. yet he has a Hall of Fame resume already, continues to deliver, and a match that, for all intents and purposes, was relatively cold. It wasn't a long-term rivalry, but Rollins and Miz went out there and tore it down on Monday Night Raw and has the WWE Universe going, wow, where's this Miz been? We didn't realize Miz was that good. Listen to ATB. We will happily tell you on a regular basis how talented and valuable the Miz is. I can't say enough good about Seth freaking Rollins. And it leads me in a nice natural transition with a little bow on it, KP, to ask the question, with the upcoming WWE draft, which takes place 1 week from today, if you're listening to this on Friday in audio form, as you should be, or this coming Friday, if you're watching on YouTube on Monday, WWE draft begins on Friday night. SmackDown continues on Monday Night Raw. Miz stock had to rocket up after Monday night. Seth Rollins has to be a first, second, no let lower than third round pick for anybody watching WWE in any capacity. Otherwise, I'll tell you, you're wrong. I'd say that was a stock raising performance for both.
Yeah, 100%. We had lots of things to touch on in the match that we simply couldn't get there. I spoke with The Miz earlier on in the day and I said, hey, how was the show? Stephen A. Smith, he's hanging out with Odell Beckham Jr. and Nick Cannon. But those were things I was never going to mention because of the rage and the fire within the eyes of The Miz. As we saw in the match, he was fired up and it was a wonderful reminder. You had said it the week before about the Usos, remember who you are. Well, it was a reminder from The Miz on Monday night as to what he's capable of. I said it in commentary, the only two-time Grand Slam champions in WWE history doing battle in The Miz and Seth freaking Rollins. I'd love to see that match each and every week.
Well, this is your opportunity, KP, to put the pieces in order to see just that, or whatever it is that Kevin Patrick envisions Friday Night SmackDown and or Monday Night Raw to look like. So we've organized with the assistance of our talented producer, Alex Metz, who will be joining us here momentarily, and you will see his handsome face if you are watching us on the official WWE YouTube channel. Alex has gone to great lengths and put in a great deal of work to organize something of a mock draft here on ATB. Mock drafts are all the thing. Fantasy football, real NFL draft coming up around the corner. Everyone has their opinion on what things should look like. So KP, you and I are going to get to play GMs.
Okay.
This is going to be your opportunity to be the general manager. I'm assigning you Friday Night SmackDown just because Raw over the past few years has become home to me. And
okay,
well, I'm pulling the vet card on you here. I'm staying on Monday Night Raw. It's a longer show. I got a little more experience, a little more time in the trenches to flesh out what Monday Night Raw might look like. And I made reference on Monday that I think I could do Adam Pearce's job better than he can. And I stand by that. I'm not saying any further. I'm going to let the internet continue to speculate as I've been tagged in quite a few tweets. I think I would be a great GM. With that said, I'm going to throw it to Alex. And Alex, you can explain the rules that you have established for this here mock WWE draft 2023.
Thank you, Corey. Kevin, hello, how are you? The rules of today's draft are very simple. I will flip a virtual coin to decide who will have the first pick in the draft. And then after that, you guys will kind of ping pong back and forth. You'll each make five picks. Your top five picks of who you would like to build your hypothetical Monday Night Raw or your hypothetical Friday Night SmackDown roster with. The only caveat: Roman Reigns, the WWE Undisputed Universal Champion, is not available in this draft.
What?
I understand that. We know Roman does what Roman wants to do. And when he wants to do it on SmackDown, he does it on SmackDown. When he wants to do it on Raw, he does it on Raw. And let's be honest, nobody's taking down the head of the table in the immediate future. So I agree with that, Alex. I like that. And I want to throw this caveat in there that this may not actually be how the draft occurs on WWE programming.
Yeah, correct,
The format has changed numerous times over the years. Sometimes Raw gets three picks to SmackDown's two because of the time constraints. Sometimes it's one for one. It's been any number of ways. So don't take our word for this. This isn't necessarily how the draft is going to play out. This is for us. We're pretending. We're having fun on ATB.
Yes, this is the ATB version of the WWE draft. This is not necessarily what you will see on your television screens in a couple weeks. But as I said, I'll flip a coin here in a second. Whoever picks the winning coin flip will go first, and it'll ping pong back and forth after that. You guys will then make your pick. We'll keep track. And when you make your pick, just give us, give us your reasons why. Explain a little bit why you're selecting this superstar or this tag team or this woman or this, you know, NXT superstar, whoever you're choosing in your top five. And I'd just like to point out there also, Graves and KP, they have not discussed any of this in advance. This is all brand new. They have their draft boards, and you guys can talk a little bit about that in a second, how you kind of built this out for who you want to select. So there is a chance here that Graves may take somebody that KP had on his board and vice versa. So, you know, expletives may start flying here in a little bit. So just be prepared for that.
Okay. So what are you going to do? Flip a coin?
Yep. I'm going to flip it right now to figure out exactly who's going to be going first. The coin is flipping on google.com right now, and it is Tails, which I have assigned to Friday Night SmackDown. So KP,
get in.
Have the
Come
first
on.
Overall pick in the draft.
So this is when philosophy comes into play, right? What do you want on your show? Fox, what do you want on a Friday night? We know Roman is going to bounce between shows. I want entertainment. I want a winner. I want someone who captivates the audience. I want, as my number one pick for Friday Night SmackDown, Seth freaking Rollins.
I quit general managing. I'm done. We're not even halfway through the first round, and you screwed me already, KP. Seth freaking Rollins, great pick. Amazing pick. That was my number one pick. I'm not going to show you the rest, but his name was highlighted at the very top of my list there in bold in my notes app because I had to have Seth freaking Rollins. I don't blame you, but I am going to counter because I understand why you would pick Seth freaking Rollins to be the man to carry the flag on Friday Night SmackDown. I'm going to answer with the almighty Bobby Lashley, because Bobby Lashley to me is box office. We saw how Bobby Lashley got red hot when he became WWE champion, the clashes with Brock Lesnar. I feel like Bobby's maybe, I don't want to say lost his way, but it seems like maybe Bobby has taken his eye off of the goal at the moment. I feel that with my powers as general manager of Monday Night Raw, I could get the almighty back to the top of the mountain and be big time box office for several years to come.
Outstanding pick. Okay.
All right. So at the end of round one, Seth freaking Rollins goes to Friday Night SmackDown and Bobby Lashley stays on Monday Night Raw. So we're going back to Kevin Patrick for round two.
This is so incredibly difficult. But my second pick, getting drafted in at number two on Friday Night SmackDown, Rhea Ripley.
I hate you. Legitimately, Kevin Patrick, two for two. You had my top two.
Rhea Ripley.
This is where it gets interesting, because if this is a legitimate competition between brands, if you're keeping your Friday Night SmackDown Women's Champion Rhea Ripley, I'm going to counter with the EST. Because they're 1 and 1A. I thought it was going to be clever to flip the script and say, I'm going to steal the SmackDown Women's Champion. I'm going to keep Bianca Belair because we need her steering the ship for Monday Night Raw in their division, particularly with the departure of Rhea Ripley.
Wow, would you call that a forced pick there, Corey?
I would. I would call it forced. But if I had my druthers, because I get to be a fan from time to time, I think Rhea Ripley right now has a little bit more of an upside. And I'm talking about at this particular point in time, at this the way everything is lined up within WWE, Rhea has just begun her ascent. She is the SmackDown Women's Champion, but her momentum is still building. Bianca has been sitting at the top of the mountain for a year now, and nobody's going to knock her off anytime soon that I can see. I'm just thinking Rhea still has, I believe, a little more of that hunger. She still has a little more to prove, and I like that in a draft pick. But I'm not disappointed with Bianca Belair at number two.
Of course not. And by force picked, I mean like almost in the sense of, okay, I just, you know, the SmackDown Women's Champion was my pick. Now I need to make sure that a champion is coming over in the top picks here to
I'm shoring
to
up the show, baby.
Yeah, absolutely.
I'm feeling good about where SmackDown is right now.
All right, KP, let's kick off round number three.
Okay. Again, bouncing back and forth here. But I think I have my decision. Selected in the third round for Friday Night SmackDown, the American Nightmare, Cody Rhodes. If Gravy could jump through our Zoom chat right now and grab a hold of me, he would.
I'm about to unplug my own computer just so I don't have to suffer through any more of this. But you know what? Okay, that's fine, KP. You want to play games? We're gonna be in competition for one another. I'm throwing a curveball at you. I'm going to come at you and hit you from an angle you never prepared for in any way, shape, or form. Monday Night Raw is a three-hour show. We've got a lot more time to fill with content, and you want content to be as high quality as possible. Perhaps something people haven't seen before. In my opinion, something people haven't seen enough of yet. We just talked about the value that The Miz brings to the table. But let's be honest. Miz is probably closer to the end of his career than he is to the beginning. So, with all due respect, I don't mean this as a detriment. I'm not trying to speak ill of or less than The Miz because I hold him in the highest regard. I'm looking to the future. I am looking toward a person who I believe could be a Miz-like character and presence on WWE programming for years to come. And I'm going down to Florida to the NXT Performance Center, and I am selecting Grayson Waller for Monday Night Raw.
Outstanding pick. Outstanding pick. Love that. So the Aussies getting promoted to Monday Night Raw.
I just thought, you know what I think of Grayson Waller. I talk about him a lot on here. I've even talked about him on Monday Night Raw. The guy entertains me. He can go in the ring. He's got time on his side. But if you need to put him out there and you need to keep him in the ring and have people engaged for a significant period of time, man, Grayson Waller's got the chops on the mic already. That, to me, is one of, if not the most valuable skills in this business. Grayson Waller at my pick.
Now, the draft experts must ask, Corey Graves, is that pick a bit of a reach on your part in the sense of that maybe he's a great value pick, but could you have maybe picked up a Grayson Waller in rounds 4 or 5 instead of round 3?
No, because you know what? You need pressure to create a diamond. I don't want somebody to slip through the cracks. And when you spend money on a draft pick or you pay a free agent in other sports, there's an obligation to produce right out of the gate. You don't necessarily, I mean, occasionally you'll draft a quarterback for next year or the future, but that's even kind of changed. It's a what can you do for me now type of world. And I think Grayson Waller has the ability now to be put into a relatively high profile situation. Sure, the fans aren't all going to know him yet, but I think that guy has the ability to swim, not sink.
Absolutely love it. So KP, you can kick us off in round number 4.
In round number 4, Friday Night SmackDown selects Montez Ford.
This is not even funny. This is legitimately upsetting. I had a few in my back pocket. He's not going to just take Montez Ford. I was planning on taking both Street Profits for a number of reasons, but since you love to drive wedges, since you love to sow dissent between the Bloodline and now the Street Profits, and you just want to split everybody up, KP, so no one could be happy, explain your reasoning.
My reasoning is this. I think Montez Ford has stupidly high potential. I mean, you speak to the guy backstage, you see what he's capable of, whether it's his in-ring Spider-Man antics, whether it's on the microphone. I think Montez Ford is a future singles champion, hopefully another reign as champion alongside Dawkins. I think Dawkins' future is incredible as well on an individual front. But for me, Montez is the man. I would invest in Montez Ford if I could. And that's the reason I select him number 4 for Friday Night Smack.
All right. You'll get no disagreement from me about anything that you just said regarding Montez Ford, but it does show your inexperience, KP, because here in WWE, you can use a draft pick to draft a whole tag team. I had planned on drafting both Street Profits because, yes, I agree that Montez Ford is likely a main eventer in the very near future, but Angelo Dawkins competes with a chip on his shoulder who is second to none, and you get 2-for-1, 2 potential breakout single stars in a singular tag team, which leads me to counter you with Jimmy and Jay, the Usos.
Because you're the tools, and we the ones.
We've got main event Jay Uso. I believe Jimmy still has the same type of ability to main event on a singular level. And oh, by the way, as it stands, the greatest tag team of the modern era, if not all time. I'm going Usos at number 4.
Man.
Now I get more bang for my buck. Yeah. It's economics, KP. I should be a general manager.
Yeah, no, something. No, because like you made a schoolboy error.
I don't know.
You made a schoolboy error in what you did because I still have one pick remaining.
Okay.
So for Friday Night SmackDown, I select.
Wait, hold on, KP. Before we get there, let's just give a quick recap for, so far, so okay. Everybody following along. So Friday Night SmackDown, at the end of four rounds, Seth freaking Rollins, Rhea Ripley, Cody Rhodes, and Montez Ford of the Street Profits. At the end of four rounds, Monday Night Raw, Corey Graves, Bobby Lashley, Bianca Belair, NXT's Grayson Waller, and the Usos. So KP, this is round number five. This is our final round. You can now begin. Or you are on the clock, as I should say.
Oh, this is hard, man. This is hard. Can we not go to 10 each, no? Is this it?
No, KP, we're running out of time. Trish, we don't want to keep Trish Stratus waiting. Come on,
that's fair,
now.
That's fair. Friday Night SmackDown selects Sami Zayn and Kevin Owens.
All right, all right. You used my own logic against me at a very high level. So I can't even...
It was a schoolboy error on your part.
Well, I wouldn't say a schoolboy error. Maybe I got a little overzealous in explaining my thought process, because I might have doubled down and gotten four for the price of two if you're going that way. So you're welcome. I'm taking credit for that great pick that you just made, KP. And I am going to answer with, you know, I'm a big future guy. I like to look forward as to someone I can build around, build my team around. And someone who has lived up to the hype in every sense of the word thus far. My final pick of five, Austin Theory. Austin Theory, period. This is the guy that just beat John Cena at WrestleMania. I don't think I'm speaking out of school when I say everybody watching WWE knows, everybody internally in WWE knows, Austin Theory has got what it takes to be the guy. If he can keep his head on straight, we're going to be watching Austin Theory for a while to come. Hopefully he stays sane and healthy, but that dude is all upside. And by the way, he's already United States champion. So
I cannot believe when I look at some of these names, and this is why it's so difficult. The Miz, we mentioned. Charlotte Flair. Becky Lynch. This is Gunther. Sheamus. Drew McIntyre. Like, wow, this is difficult.
It's impossible. It's impossible. Yeah. I look at my list and I realize, well, half of my list's already on Monday Night Raw, but sometimes it's about keeping. And I think Raw has been in a really, really sweet spot lately. So you don't want to necessarily blow things up all the time just because it's different. I think you add a little piece here, a little bit there. You've got a good machine. You got a good base. So yeah, you throw in like a Grayson Waller. You make the Usos full-time exclusive. I mean, I think we both did fairly well. I mean, I would... Yeah. Not disagree with any of the picks you just made, except for the fact that I didn't make them.
You're in the doghouse, though, not picking your wife.
KP, you know what? I've had it with you. This is why this is ridiculous. This is my podcast. I invite you on. You outdraft me and then insult me.
I'm going to get it from all the Irish.
Look how happy you are.
I didn't pick Becky Finn or Sheamus.
I hope the squirrels win, KP. I hope the squirrels win.
You know what? That's a low blow.
No.
That's a low blow.
Nope. I hope your wife gets to sleep in your lovely bedroom and your children are unbothered by the squirrels and that you are on ladders all day in precarious positions leaning up against. I hope you Clark Griswold yourself, KP. Yeah. That's what I hope. I want a photo. I want a selfie of you hanging by the roof from the sleeve of your shirt. With a squirrel smiling with peanuts in its cheeks, looking at your misfortune.
Yeah, I wish you flight delays this weekend. Oh. How about that, huh?
And you know what? You're probably going to win that. You're going to win that.
Before we wrap up here, guys, we have an esteemed panel of draft experts that have been watching live this entire time that has been submitting their draft grades as we've been talking here. So if you would indulge me for a minute, I could provide those with you, before we bring on Trish. So KP... The four panelists graded your draft as follows: A+, A, and A for Friday Night SmackDown. So let's average that out to about an A. Corey Graves for Monday Night Raw. Our four panelists graded your drafts: B+, C, and B.
Fired. You're all fired. I don't even know who these people are. Who are they to come onto my show and question my draft picks?
Fair point.
They're the After the Bell draft experts, of course.
You're sounding like Logan Roy now, Graves.
Off. You got me all wound up. I'm over-caffeinated. I'm under-rested. Thank you, Alex, for helping me ruin my own damn show. Thank you, KP, for absolutely nothing. I'm centering myself.
Oh, poor Trish Stratus.
I'm composing myself. I'm holding it back together. To the best of my ability as a professional, because it is, despite all the insults that I have endured over the past several minutes from my own people, it is still my great honor and pleasure to introduce to the ATB faithful a WWE Hall of Famer. She is a self-proclaimed and proclaimed by many, potentially myself included, greatest of all time, Trish Stratus. First things first, Trish, thank you for taking time out of your insanely busy schedule to hang out with us here on After the Bell. You got the WWE buzzing yet again this past Monday night on Raw, where you dropped some pretty heavy truth bombs. So it is our pleasure and honor to offer you up this platform to dive a little bit into a little deeper into what has been plaguing the Hall of Famer herself. And I would like to start the interview by disarming you, by complimenting you on your brand new t-shirt.
Yes.
Oh, thank you. Mm-hmm. Yeah, in case, you know, I was going to wait for a WWE shop to make it. So I made it myself. It's available at my shop, trishstratus.com, stratusforshop.com. But thank you. And I'll send you yours for that plug. Thank you.
See, there we go, KP. That's why I'm a professional. You disarm the guest, and then you start hitting the heavy questions. But Trish, we saw a side of you on Monday night that we have not seen in quite some time, particularly since making your returns. Several years back, you competed with Charlotte Flair. Obviously, you had your WrestleMania match this year. But where did all this sort of come from? Start at the genesis of this frustration with me. What has changed so drastically in your time away that you felt the need to sort of boil over like you did?
It's not that it's, you know, I think maybe coming back this last time, it's sort of been an underlying thing. I've seen the interviews, sat back, I've watched it, and it's about like, you know, I, to be honest, I guess being there with Becky and seeing, you know, that there was no moments of acknowledgement and there was no like recognizing how special this was. And it kind of irked me a little bit, to be honest, you know, because I mean, I was fully aware, like, you know, just the match, the WrestleMania match itself, what an interesting dynamic, right? We have this multi-generational face-off and you have the past, the present, the future, me and Lita being the past, of course, Becky and Bayley being the present and Dakota and Io being the future. So how interesting. And I, you know, as a fan, as a superstar, everything, recognize how amazing it was. Did I love watching everyone in the ring? Even when I was apron, watching everyone do their thing. I love that. I love seeing how, you know, I've influenced them and how I've, you know, I could see my mannerisms. I know that Bayley has talked about how me and Lita have influenced her. And you know, so I saw it. But the one person that really, really didn't really acknowledge it much was Becky. And I thought that's a bit off. And maybe she's super focused. Maybe she's super focused on the match and we'll get through these things. But there was never, I don't know. I just felt like, and listen, I'm all about like real recognizing real. So it's like, that's why for me, like, I think Becky to me is like top tier, man. She is amazing. She's not, she's the number one female to me in the land, the current landscape. And so that's all I was kind of looking for. And it just, and I don't need my rub. I don't need my ego rubbed, but it was just a little bit like, just like aloof, maybe rather aloof and just not that thankful. And it's like, you know, listen, I've spent my entire career. I am where I am in my career, but I've definitely made a point of thanking the people. The golden era and the top, you know, the division that made all you guys care about women's wrestling, the Mollies and the Victorias and Jazzes, like to me, I recognize those are the ones that made me in the ring. Those are the ones that all together we did it. I mean, it was me more consistently, but for the most part, I mean, I'm always recognizing that it was, you know, that it's a team effort and whatever, but I just didn't feel that from her. And it kind of bugged me a bit, to be honest.
So why Lita? Why attack Lita the way you did then to get to Becky? I mean, we all know about your past with Lita and your friendship with Lita too.
Well, I felt like in order for my message to be clearly delivered and to make a statement that you would sit up and take notice would be to just sort of shift her out of the picture. And now all eyes are here and I can have all your undivided attention and tell you what's on my mind.
Is this something that's been weighing on you for a long time? Because it seems as though there is a very clear divide in the history of women's wrestling in WWE. There was Trish Stratus, Lita's era, but then, of course, as you referenced on Monday Night Raw, the women's evolution, the women's revolution, it became branded, it became big, and the Four Horsewomen do receive a lot of the credit. Is that something that you were aware of even in the midst of the women's evolution, or did it kind of take time for you to step back and go, oh, wait a minute, I haven't gotten my flowers yet?
Yeah, no, I was clear right away that there was no flowers coming my way. So I was like, well, that's not cool, you know? And also just like me and Lita, was it me and Lita? I mean, was it or was it me? Like, I don't know. I'm pretty, if I want to look back specifically, I'm pretty sure she had a broken neck most of the time I was there breaking records and doing the rounds and doing the press conferences, being on the, you know, the loop, so to speak, you know? So, you know, yeah. I feel like I said, I had to clearly deliver a message, and that was the best way for me to do that.
So as somebody who has existed at a very high level on both sides of, we'll call it the divide, the cutoff, the pre-evolution, post-evolution, what are some of the differences that you notice just as a whole, just as an observer in the locker room, in the business, as to how the women's division is treated and exists now versus when you were trying to, you know, blaze your own trail?
Well, that's the whole thing, is we had to, there was no trail, right? Right now they have a trail that they get to then make and make their own and make their turns and stuff like that. But for us, there was nothing. There was literally nothing. So we had to create that. There was no interest from the fans or backstage. There was, you know, I was told point blank, they don't want to see the women do that. So, okay. That was our first obstacle we had. We thought that we were told the fans don't want to see that. And the fans were not conditioned to see that. So we had the puppy chants and we had the stuff because that's what we're giving them. I knew what I was capable of. I knew I had done the training. I knew that, like, you know, I trained with all guys. I was the only girl in my school, like with Ron Hutchison in Toronto. I was the only chick there. And they were treating me like a chick at first. I'm going to just treat me like one of the boys. And that's been my whole thing, is like treating me like one of the boys. And so we had to sort of re-educate the fans. So I knew I was capable of going in and doing it. And so when we were finally, you know, we had to like sort of re-educate the fans, and we had to fly in under the radar. And it was hard. It was hard work because we had to sit through the puppy, we had to work our asses off and sit through the puppy's chants. But to get to the point where then they stopped saying puppies and they were saying holy during our match, you know, and that was a lot of work. So for them to know that they don't have those puppy chants, they already have the holy chants and this is awesome chants. But like, how do you think we are the ones who conditioned the fans to give you that action? So we are the ones who gave you that path. So like, just a little acknowledgement is all, you know, I think that's important because, like I said, I recognize what we did. I recognize all the girls that collectively we did this together. And we created this really, I mean, I don't know, we created a vocation. Back in the day, people say to me all the time, you know, in interviews, they say, like, did you always know you want to become a wrestler? Well, no, of course not. That was not an option back then. It absolutely was not an option. I could look at maybe Miss Elizabeth. I mean, yes, there was Wendy Rector one time, and yes, there was China, but they were like almost like, you know, this entity on their own, right?
There were more attractions than the regular, yeah.
Exactly. Nothing that you could be like, oh, on the scope of this show or the scope of this presentation, you know, that's something I could do. No, it was neat to see. But then, yeah, there was a point where now we made it a part of the world of wrestling. Like, you now, we changed the preconceived notion of what a female could do in the ring to the point where now you have little girls going, when I grow up, I want to be a wrestler. Like, we created a vocation, so to speak, right? And I say we, but I mean, it was mostly me for the most part. I mean, I was there for that whole
run.
You were
the face. Listen, I was a fan. I watched religiously, and you were definitely the face of the division. Obviously, you need a partner to dance with. But as far as when you saw WWE was coming to town or you saw WWE merchandise, it was generally Trish Stratus's face, or you were represented somewhere on, you know, as far as women go every time.
Yeah, it's true. And I mean, I'm not to be an ass, right? But it just, that's the way they presented me. But that was the work, right? That was like, cool, let's do this. Let's, you know, when Victoria came into the picture, we're going to, now that like you've stood up and taken notice, thanks to the great work of Molly Holly and Ivory, the work that we did to like, I mean, and the work they did with me, having me come up and, you know, be green, but then slowly, you know, the fans saw me fall down, but stand up again, dust myself off and go to work, you know, and they have that connection with me because they watched me get better. They saw me try to outdo my last performance and stuff like that. So being with Ivory, Victoria, we now are like, oh, okay, now we wrestle, guys. Yeah, we go with this. We can wrestle. Cool. So the fans are like, we got this. Then let's bring Victoria in. Different angle. We're going to go hardcore. We're going to show that we get a little crazy. We can take a chair shot now too. I mean, taking one chair shot was a big deal. You know, now it's like there's 17 chair shots in one women's match. Like, we did that, you know?
Talk to me a little more about Victoria, because she's someone who, again, I was a big fan of before I got into the business, and her name constantly comes up. from
but
anybody.
Not in the Hall of Fame, Tom.
Right, right. And that was where I was getting you. You beat me to the punch. Yeah. So talk to me about Victoria's influence on the women's division as a whole.
Oh, I mean, we were right there. We were at the point, like I said, where fans were like, okay, I think we're digging this. Women can wrestle. Cool. Yeah, I'll watch. I won't go to the bathroom during this segment then. And they would tune in. And then Victoria and I came and we knew. We were like, okay, wow, we got them. Now they're giving us like characters and storyline development. And we're actually going to have a package before we go and wrestle. We didn't get that before. Now we get it just like the guys, you know. But Victoria was there and we were at that moment where we turned the corner for women's wrestling, where we're like, now that we're accepted, this is an acceptable part of the show, we're gonna take it to another level. We're gonna go hardcore. We're gonna do stuff that like you didn't see the woman do. And we killed our bodies doing it. And you know, I find it so crazy that she's so underrated, underrecognized, as you're saying as well. Like, I'm like, how many times are we gonna have a Hall of Fame? I love Tori Wilson and Stacey Kubler, but this is a wrestling. And I know we don't say wrestling for some reason. I don't know why, because I am a wrestler and we work for World Wrestling Entertainment. But yeah, like, I mean, I'd like to see, maybe could a wrestler maybe get into the Hall of Fame next? Maybe like Victoria would be great, you know?
Love it.
Maybe
love
I'm crazy.
No, beautifully said. Oh. Beautifully said. So Trish, do you feel you've put millions in the bank accounts of the current female superstars today, and they should absolutely be thanking you for all you've done? That's clearly what I'm getting from this, is that you are no nostalgia act, is the word you used. And you said Becky's believing her own hype. Like, Becky calls herself the man, yet you're the one, like you said, we're training with the boys. You're the one who are out there, you know, doing it alongside the guys. So were you the original, the man?
Is that a question or a statement?
I think it's kind of both, actually.
I think it's a statement, right? I mean, I was the original, right? I mean, I am the OG. Like, I mean, it's like we joke, oh, you're the OG. I mean, right? I mean, and it's crazy to me. Like, everyone's got these monikers. Like, we've got the EST, we've got the man and the queen, and I'm just going to be Trish Stratus. That's my moniker. So, you know, yeah, I mean, and then you hear the stories and they'll talk about how, like, oh, I was influenced, but I've never seen Becky really acknowledge the past. I mean, you have to. Everyone came from someone. Everyone was influenced by something. I mean, absolutely. Like I said, sure, call yourself the man. Do your, you know, get your, brag about your accomplishments. Because she's, like I said, she is, to me, she is number one. I love what she does in the ring. I think she's great. But just, yeah, just to sort of be a little more humble, maybe, or just to, maybe just to recognize, that's all, you know?
Let me ask you this, Trish. Do you think one of the reasons that perhaps you aren't acknowledged to the level that you would like to be is just sort of the shift in society and people who watch WWE and all of sports entertainment as a whole? And there's a lot of work done to sort of get away from the sexualization or the sexy nature of what the Divas era really presented. Do you look back at that with any sort of regret, or do you look at that as just part of your journey on the way to what we have now?
Yeah, it was part of the work. It was to me, looking at it like, this is the platform that's available. I will use it then to deliver the message I want to deliver. So it took me, if I knew I had to go and, you know, do a couple of these things that we didn't want to do. But then eventually, now that I have your attention, I'm going to also throw in, like, instead of a cat fight, you're going to see. And listen, an example, we were getting some matches, and I know Fit and I were working. We were super excited about, like, okay, we're really doing some good work here. And then it was like, Thanksgiving. And, well, we got a gravy bowl match. And it was like, really? And we were like, oh, we were so disappointed, right? But I was like, you know what, though? So if I'm going to have a gravy, to me, it's like the lemon, I'm going to make my lemonade out of this. Then I'm going to, so the spot is, instead of just getting thrown into the gravy, throw me off the stage. And then they chanted, holy. So now I've got your attention. And now you know, like, I'm going to do a stupid gravy bowl match, but I'm also going to do it in a kick-ass way, and I'm going to show you my athleticism. I need to take, because this is the platform I'm given, fine. But then I'm going to use it to showcase the other things and show different sides of it, you know? That was the work we had to do.
Isn't that the ultimate lesson for everybody? To make that lemonade, like you say, because we often see it backstage. There'll be folks moaning that they're only part of a backstage promo, perhaps, yeah. Or their match might be 2 minutes. But it's what you can make out of those 2 minutes, right?
Oh, you say 2 minutes. That's literally all we had. Right. Yeah, like, you have a 2 minute match. You have a 4 minute match. And, you know, these girls get 7 minute, 10 minute, 15, 20 minute on my main event of WrestleMania. Well, you're welcome. You know, like, it's because we got you there. It was the steps that were taken. It was the work that was done. It was the trail that was blazed. It was the foundation that we laid. We lay the foundation. I mean, the foundation was laid. You build your skyscraper. Absolutely. I'm going to give you your flowers 100%. But like, let's recognize that without that strong foundation, there's no way that structure is standing tall.
Who did you lean on when you and your era were sort of trying to define what you wanted it to be? Because you didn't, to your point, have somebody who came before you, at least not at that level, that you could go to for advice or say, hey, how did you accomplish that? You were obviously the landscape, the business was a totally different environment back then. So who really helped Trish along the way sort of develop into to what you would eventually come to be?
Well, Fit for sure. He was my, we were like freaking frat. Like we had a vision together. He just knew. He was like, I don't want to do the cat fight. He's like, then don't. Let's, because they literally, and we were like, we luckily were under the radar. They're like, oh, just go to your women's match, whatever. And we were toll playing fake. Like when I remember doing a live event and it was like, I was laying in punches or something. Like, oh, they don't want to see that. They want to see the hair pull. You know, they want to see that. I'm like, do they? Because I'm pretty sure they responded quite well to my punching, you know? And so Fit and I were like, we were like under the radar, almost like nobody paying attention. We're going to throw some chops in. We're going to do some, you know, instead of the hair pulls and a slap, we're going to do chops and we're going to do punches and we're going to see how that goes. And no one was paying attention. It was like, this is a girls match. So luckily we were like, slip that in. But then the fans were the ones who were like, oh, this is cool. And they were kind of like, oh, this is good. This, let's a lot more of that. And they demanded it. So, and then of course, you know, we listen to WWE Universe most of the time. And so there was a point where Vince came to me and he said, you know, because they would do this thing, and I don't know if they still do it, but at live events, they would pull the first couple rows of the show and just ask, what was your favorite match? And they would, you know, list them or something like that. And so we were starting to, me and Jazz were working, and we were being added to the list. And so Vince literally came to me and just said, wow, like you guys, they're talking about you and Jazz. That's, we've never heard the girls match being mentioned amongst the boys matches, right? Yeah. And so the work was being done and people were starting to take notice, but it took them to like then want that we could then, it was acceptable for us to do these things in our matches.
That's pretty interesting. And that truly is like a grassroots sort of campaign to start there. And because the first few rows were appreciating and acknowledging fast forward all these years, here we are now, which begs the question, what is left for the women to do that has not yet been accomplished in your opinion? What would you still like to see? I mean, they've headlined WrestleMania, right? That's the pinnacle. That is the pinnacle of this industry. But everybody always has a, you know, different point of view, a different perspective. What would you like to see more of? What would you like to see less of in today's product?
More of Trish Stratus, I guess, would be the
fair
answer.
I mean, it's probably a popular
opinion. Yeah, we haven't seen that in today's product. I mean, that's why, I mean, I feel like, you know, every time I come back, right, there's a few boxes I want to check. Is it interesting? Will it be intriguing to the fans? Will it do something with the other generations? And will I be challenged, right? As a performer, as an entertainer, what I've done in my life, you know, I've 23 years, I've debuted 23 years ago. It's insane to even say that out loud. Cause I know I look 25. So, you know, it's like, so it's like, can I still do this? So that's what's driving me, is that challenge of being like, damn right, I can. I can go out there and I'm going to run circles with any one of you. Like, let's do it, you know? And being at WrestleMania again was just like a reminder. My body was like, yeah, okay. Just, it's like, people were like, were you nervous? It's been so long. To be honest, it just felt like being at home. I was like, this is what I do. It really is what I do, you know?
So is that what you meant by the, you're not a nostalgia act. This isn't a one and you're here to do what you do to the highest of your abilities.
Yeah. I mean, and that's just maybe a little reminder for people. Like maybe you forgot, but then, you know, you saw me at WrestleMania, you saw me come out on Monday and like, and it's like, that's a good female promo, or just how about just a superstar promo? Forget, let's, you know, females and males. And we're just superstars in the show. And we've started to establish it, but there's still those signs of like, no, the girls match and the whatever, you know? So let's like, I want to erase that. Let's just, I want you to remember me as the best superstar that ever existed in WWE, period. So
you said I have their attention now, talking about Becky and Lita. You have their attention for sure. Is it simply more with them now, or do you want to move your attention to gold?
I mean, I like shiny things. I'm no, you know, listen, nowadays they have the luxury of competing for how many titles? You know, I held the title for, and I mean, I'm just going to throw this out here. I'm not a numbers person necessarily. But I mean, my retirement match, I retired as champion. So I don't know. Am I technically?
Fair point.
You're still the champion. Yep.
I mean, I know. Roman Reigns is doing his thing right now, right? And what is his number count at? It's like, what, how many days?
We're approaching 1,000.
Yeah.
I mean, I might be at 6,000 right now.
Yes.
So.
I mean, that's approaching Moolah, I believe, was champion for like 23 years straight.
But, okay. But, yeah. So, but you know, I mean, is she as hot as me, though? I mean, that's also a factor.
I'm going to put you on the spot because I'm looking through the Zoom call at you, and you had a line amongst your fantastic promo the other night on Monday Night Raw, and you said, "I'm not your childhood fantasy." And every male in that arena looked at each other and went, "Wait, are we not allowed? Wait a minute. Is that something that did you ever think about that when you're just doing what you do now? Like, wait, man, these guys all grew up idolizing me."
No, I don't really think I did not think about that when I put my cowboy hat on and my trench coat jacket. I did not. Nope, didn't think about that at all.
No intent that you wore a gear at WrestleMania that was similar to something. No, okay.
Nah.
I just want to clarify that, just for anybody who might be wondering.
Yeah. I mean, if they have their fantasies, they do. I don't know. I don't know what they think of, whatever. But I just walked the ring, and whatever was happening behind me, I'm not sure.
And you can't be held responsible for. So
No.
We've absolved Trish of all the blame.
Yeah. What's the secret sauce, Trish, with not skipping a beat, whether it's in the ring or delivering a passionate promo the way we saw after potentially years of not doing it, to just jump right back in and not a bother to you? What's the secret sauce there?
I guess it's just like born to do what you do. Like, I feel like this is what I was born to do. And I've made a career out of being the best. Like, I want to be the best at what I do, no matter what I do. I'm a hardcore, when I'm mom, I am hardcore mom. Like, you know, I am making the fruit that shapes with the food, with the looks like bunnies, like, you know, I go all out. Like, so whatever I do, I want to be the best at it. So I don't know. That's what I've done my whole life. So anytime you give me something to do, like, I'm going to go out, I want to be your best judge on Canada's Got Talent. I want to be the best mom. This is what I do, you know? So that's, I don't know, a healthy lifestyle, good mindset, positive outlook, all that, of course, is like my MO. This is how I live my life. I keep my, you know, everyone's like, how did you get in ring shape? I don't let it go and then get ready just for the WrestleMania thing. This is my life. Like, I do yoga daily. I work out constantly. I eat clean. I take care of the vessel, so to speak. Preparedness meets opportunity. That's been my motto. It's been my sort of my mantra for my entire life. So like any opportunity I've been given in my entire life, because I think people are given opportunities all the time and they just go, she's so lucky there's no luck, right? Like, and it might be, you might have a lucky moment, but if you don't take full advantage of it, then that's your fault. So for me, it's like preparedness meets opportunity, but recognizing when those opportunities come and being 100% prepared for it in order to maximize it. And so, you know, did I know I was going to go back to wrestling? No, but like, let's keep in ring shape. Let's keep conditioning. Let's keep on top of the product. Let's watch it closely in case there's a moment. And if their opportunity presents itself.
What was there a moment? I mean, you obviously have had great success in your personal life outside of WWE, but to come back recently, something had to spark that. What was there a moment, or was it just sort of a slow process into getting the itch again?
I took a keen interest in Becky Lynch. I guess it was last summer when they had done a live event here in Toronto, and we started in a little exchange of words, and people were interested, which I thought, that's interesting how interested they are in this. And I just think, and I did a post right before WrestleMania where I just said, you know, I was like, oh, it's so cool because like Lita and Becky are lying. Like they marched their own beat and they're, you know, but to me, I saw a lot of me and Becky. I see the drive and the passion and the, you know, unequivocally will not accept anything less than excellence, right? That is what I did. And I see that in her. And so I was like, I see it in her too, which I admired and I loved that. But then being with her, I was like, you know, they say don't meet your heroes. Not that she was my hero. I should be her hero. But I was just like, oh, okay, cool. Yeah, okay, cool, that's fine. And then it just was too much, you know? And she was just very patronizing on that end there. There was that little end note, and we did win that match, you know, because of whatever reason. But it was just like, it's okay, we'll get him next time. And that, you know, I don't know. It just felt like the right moment to deliver a message.
So zero recognition from Becky. I'm hoping that other young superstars have come up and approached you looking for advice backstage, given that the Hall of Famer is back.
Yeah, they have not. It's been my door. There's been lineups at my dressing room. I'm happy to do that. I've always had great relationships with the current crop. You know, I've been very, I love to, you know, I it was something like when I got the role to be on Tough Enough. To me, I was so excited about that role because it was like a moment to like give back and to like, you know, all the experience you have. Like, and I have people in my life who, you know, I was, I was able to do what I did and achieve what I did because I had people backing me. I had Finley. I had Regal, who'd go in there and do 100 Hindu squats and then show me.
Still doesn't, by the way.
You know, I had Lance Storm. I had Tommy Dreamer. I had Bubba. I had all these guys and people who were like, saw my potential or saw my passion. And I'm like, hey, you know, and I loved it. I ate it up and I was a sponge. And that's why I got better, because I had that. And so I try to now, you know, be that ear for them. And then because there's a lot of frustrating moments, especially as a female superstar in the WWE. I want to be like, listen, we've been there, but do this or stay this, or, you know, like seeing someone like Zelina, there's moments for her. Like, I really think she's great out there. And because I look at her like, the journey of coming, she's been presented as a valet manager a lot of the times, but she's got fantastic potential. But, you know, use that, right? And I want to see more from her. But like, I think the way they present her, it's about getting to know her and then giving the fans a little bit of this and that, so that when she really has a chance to go, they're going to be invested in her. There's a lot of superstars that have, you know, I've tried to be there for Natty and stuff. I've tried to be there for them to like encourage them and keep them up. And just, I watch the product, of course, and I'll send a note and it's nice to, you know, to see the people that do acknowledge that help or that recognition.
Before we let you go, I want to get your opinions on, obviously, we've talked about the state of the women's division, but particularly the Raw and SmackDown women's champions, Bianca Belair, Rhea Ripley. Rhea just earned the crown at WrestleMania.
Yeah.
What is your opinion of these women in the roles that they're in?
I'm loving watching the development. I love, to me, it's always, because for me, it was about being this valet, but then having a character developing and getting to know her as a character, and then watching her in her role, grow in her role. And I've seen this with Rhea Ripley, and it's been wonderful to watch. You know, she's pretty special. You know, and I'm so happy to see where she's at. And Bianca, like, she's someone special. She's so athletic. She just was born to be, I feel like she's someone that like is born to do what she does, right? Like, it's so natural and so effortless for her. I love seeing her. She's a great champion. I mean, could I dethrone her? Maybe, probably, you know, but watching her, I enjoy watching her. And, I think they're both great and, also both, beatable if you're just asking my opinion. Yeah, on that,
let's not gloss over that. This is what I was fishing for. What? I was kind of hoping you would take us there, but you just
did
sort
I take
of.
You there?
Yeah, just got me right past it. What are the odds that we see Trish Stratus challenge for the Raw or SmackDown Women's Championship before you ride off back into the sunset again someday?
Pretty high. I guess the odds could be high. Mm-hmm. That's your answer.
I guess that's all I could have hoped
for.
Listen,
do really I look good in gold? Yes, I do.
And you like shiny
Do
things,
I represent right? well? Yes, I do. Can I do your press conference? Can I do your connect? Yes, I can. So, you know.
Do the fans love you? Yes, they do. The reception every time you appear, Trish, is absolutely amazing. We're here on commentary, and sometimes I got to do this and just listen to the WWE Universe. The appreciation very much there.
And then he picks his jaw up off the table, and we get to work.
It's true.
You know,
right. It's true.
Sorry for selling you out there, KP.
I had to remove all the Trish Stratus posters I have back here just to make sure they're not in show.
So, Trish, we mentioned it at the top of the interview, TrishStratus.com. What are you working on when you're not in front of the WWE Universe these days, and where can they find it?
Well, I'm a judge on Canada's Got Talent, which has been so much fun. Like, as a performer, entertainer, I remember getting the job offer, and I was like, oh, I don't know. Like, cause you think I don't sing, I don't dance. I don't, right. But I was realizing, oh, I'm a, like, and it took me to like get them to say, but you're like, you performed at this level. And I was like, oh, no, I did, you know? So like to give back. And then I see these people in their moments, you know, that they, it's preparedness means opportunity. They have this one shot, one opportunity, as Eminem says, where they're going to come out and like, they prepared for it. This is their whole moment that could change their life. Right. And so it's such an honor. It's very humbling to know that I'm a teeny part of their journey. And even with my golden buzzer, like I'll have a golden buzzer moment. I get to be a part of something that could possibly change the trajectory of their life or their career. Wow. What an honor. Right. So it's super special. And it's just to do it for Canada. Is cool. Howie Mandel's with us, Lily Singh and Cardinal Fischel. And it's so fun. It's such a nice thing. And like, you know, the fun thing is like, it's in a 5,000 person arena, which I think is bigger than the AGT platform that they use.
Right, right.
Yeah, right. And so producers always come over and they're like, you're so good with the crowd. We love what you, because I'm always like, you know, like my golden buzzer was just like, you're amazing, click. I'm like this, I stand up, I look around, I get the crowd, I drop an elbow on my elbow and my buzzer, you know, because I'm like, and they're like, that was amazing. I'm like, oh yeah. I'm like, that's why you hired a wrestler. You know, it's like, it's cool to know we like the work we did. I mean, wrestling is such a, man, a multifaceted offerings of you know, performance and there's just, it's entertainment, it's performance, it's aestheticism, it's so many things. And I'm seeing in these jobs when I do a movie, like I did a Christmas movie recently and I did, you know, Ken's Got Talent. And when I do these things, I see that like the things we learn there, I'm applying them and it's amazing. Like I'm just, you know, I'm a seasoned pro because of what I did.
It seems like such a common occurrence that you hear the stories. And obviously now you look at The Rock, biggest star in the world. John Cena is in the process. Batista's killing it in Hollywood.
Yeah.
It's such a common thing to have people with wrestling backgrounds. And then you hear that anytime you read a producer interview or see them, like, oh my God, I couldn't believe how great the wrestlers were.
Yeah.
Without fail. Yeah. 100% of the time, because it's we're used to being in a live environment where you only get one shot, to your point. So, I mean, maybe that translates. Maybe we're on to something.
When I was doing the Christmas movie, which to me was like a bucket list. It was such a fun.
You can
I did a little cameo.
You can mention it. I'm not going to like edit it out. Where can we find Trish Stratus Christmas movie?
I did a Trishmas movie. When I did it, I did a cameo once and they were doing the thing like, oh, you're so great to work with. And we recognize what it's like to work as a team and like all these things, whereas like some actors like in their zone and they don't talk to anyone. And I'm like, what's up to like the set and this, cause this is what we do at work. We talk to everybody. We're, you know, this is a team effort to put on the show that we do. Right. And so they basically looked for a role for me and offered a lead role in my own movie. Right. So I did this movie and I'm with this 30 year career veteran guy. He does theater. He does Shakespeare. He says, I've never seen. So I guess when you just a background, when you go onto set, you'll get a little like the script of the day and they're called sides. And it's the size of like a quarter of a page. And it's like all the scripts. So, and most, you know, actors keep them in their back pocket or have them quickly do their lines. Okay. And then do their scene. Right. And he said, and I didn't have mine because I read them. I've got them. We do this is what we do, right?
Right.
And even like this people on Monday were like, she had a lengthy promo. I mean, that's what we do. This is what we, you know, I've also done this for 23 years, right? But like, he's like, I've never seen an actor in all my years come on set and like not have the script with them and just had everything. Not only was I had actors are forgetting lines. I'm like, he's like, line, I'd say it. Cause like, I knew this is what we do. Like, and I'll do that. And not cause you have one shot, like you said, right. And it's live. And also improving, you got to roll with the punches sometimes and you got to change it up and listen to the crowd and be able to react accordingly. So it was cool to see like how it applied. It was like, I'm like, not bad. And it was a running joke where I'd be like, well, I'm a wrestler. So no matter what happened on set, that was a running joke. They'd be like, oh shoot, that thing fell. I'm like, I know because I'm a wrestler. Like it just was a thing, but wrestlers are awesome people. If we can call ourselves wrestlers,
do you find yourself dropping wrestling and WWE terminology when you're on like a movie set or when you're with your family or friends that haven't got a clue what you're talking about? Because I found
like,
that
oh,
when
man,
I
she healed that moment out. And they're like, you heal? What is your heel? You back of your foot is hurting. What is happening?
No. No, but I think to your point, you keep saying it's because I'm a wrestler. But I think that's what the boss had in mind when he coined the phrase superstar. Because you're not just a wrestler. It's the environment that is WWE and the live crowds and the television. And you experience so many different aspects of entertainment, back to your point, that you wouldn't as just a wrestler. But it all comes with the territory of truly being a superstar. And I think that's why it's such a big deal that we always hammer that home, is that we're not just wrestlers. Everyone's a superstar.
It's so true. We people, we're amazing.
Pretty cool.
We're awesome.
Well, Trish, thank you so much for coming and hanging out. You are always welcome on After the Bell. This was
thank
a pleasure
you.
And an honor. And I apologize for Kevin Patrick and his terrible line of questioning and failure to give you the proper respect that you so deserve.
Thank you so much. And next time, keep
love
the
you,
posters
Trish.
Up. You would have had bonus points from me.
Seriously.
So now,
I know.
Have to dig
you
them
know?
Out of the closet.
I mean, you know you have them. You know the closet on the floor. They're behind him. He knows.
You are the best. You are the best.
Trish, where can the ATB fans find you on social media?
Trish Stratus com, com at the end. And and you know, it's been fun on there lately. So check it out. Lots of stuff. You can get on my pop, you can get my shirts, you can get all kinds of stuff. It's fun.
There we go. So, make sure you're following us at After the Bell WWE on Twitter, Instagram, and Facebook. You can find me at WWE Graves. You can find him at Kev_Egan. Listen for free wherever you get your podcast. Just search After the Bell and hit the follow button so you never miss an episode. And the full official full episodes of After the Bell This doesn't even make sense, Alex. I can't read your copy.
Come on, Alex. What the hell?
Watch us on Mondays on WWE's official YouTube channel. We'll be back next week with more wisdom, more vitriol, KP's Trish Stratus posters, and more WWE After the Bell. Like what you hear? Catch full episodes of After the Bell wherever you get your podcasts. Follow us now and never miss an episode.